Okay, we'll get started now. Good afternoon again. One, two. Thank you. My name is Ruben Flores, and I'm the director of the Office of Innovation and Commercialization. I see many familiar faces in the audience today. Who has not been here before? One. Oh, there's quite a few of you. Very good. Thank you for coming. Of those new to this series, how many of you are students at UC San Diego? None. Great. Postdocs? Faculty? You're all non-UCSD affiliated. That's fantastic. Are you guys members of the community at large? That's great. That's what we want to see. And we really appreciate, you know, you guys taking the time to come here and joining us. We want you to tell your friends about this innovation series that we're running here at UC San Diego. This innovation series has the goal of sharing with the community, with investors, with students, and the public in general, some of the most breakthrough innovations that are happening in campus that have the potential to be commercialized. Some of the inventions and some of the scientific content that you will hear about today, has resulted in invention disclosures and impossible patents that are managed by our office. And our office then works with the investigators who disclose those inventions to find potential business partners, to find investors, to find companies who can help us commercialize and bring those inventions to the marketplace. That's all I'm going to say about me and about the office. And I'm going to ask my colleague Skip Seiner in the office to come here and introduce the speaker for today.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for coming here. Nathan is one of the world-class researchers in the working on the cutting edge of nanoengineering to medicine here. He's been in the San Diego area for quite some time. He received his bachelor's at University of Adelaide in 1999, and then he arrived here to and then he completed a Ph.D. at Northwestern back in around 2005, and then he arrived here with a Dow Chemical postdoctoral fellowship at TSRI in about 2008 is when he really started his career at UC San Diego. Currently, Nathan is the Teddy Traylor Scholar and Professor of Chemistry and Biochemistry of Nanoengineering and Material Science and Engineering. His lab is enjoying an interdisciplinary approach to nanomaterials research with a focus on multifunctional materials with interests that include biomedical applications, programmed interactions with biomolecules and cells, and basic research into nanoscale materials, design, synthesis, and characterization. For this, Nathan has been awarded the NIH Director's New Innovator Award, the NIH Director's Transformative Research Award, and one of the highly coveted Young Scientist Awards, the Presidential Early Career Award for Scientist and Engineer. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry. He's an Alfred P. Sloan Foundation Fellow and a Kavli Fellow of the National Academy of Sciences. Today, Nathan's going to share with us and how his group has gone about developing new methods for creating nanomaterials that can sense and respond to biological signals, and how this work could lead to new approaches for the treatment of diseases through targeted drug delivery, tissue repair, and advanced sensor design. His research program is focused on solving the problems of how synthetic materials interact with biological systems. In some cases, Nathan and his group seek to mimic biological processes using synthetic systems, and in others, his research group aimed to use completely synthetic materials for therapeutic or diagnostic purposes against heart disease and cancer. The pioneering work involves the study of polymers and polymer-based nanoparticles, as well as the development of new methods for analyzing nanomaterials with electron microscopy, which I know Nathan said he was going to talk about today. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Nathan Gianneschi, one of UC San Diego's most creative and energetic researchers in the application of nanoscience to medicine.
Okay. Thank you very much, Skip, and thank you for the invitation to come here today. I'm told I have to stand here and not move around too much because of the camera, so I'm going to try to achieve that goal at the very least. Skip and I have worked together actually for several years, and this has involved bringing several different technologies to fruition in terms of, as was stated, intellectual property. Some of these technologies, one in particular, or the platform itself in oncology applications, is imminently going to be a startup, and Skip's been fantastic, and the office has been fantastic in allowing that to happen, because without that intellectual property, of course, there's no value at all in the outcomes. You can't see much of this, but my group works in a lot of different areas. I'm going to touch on nanomedicine, as Skip mentioned, in the context of how we think about new directions for achieving delivery to tumors. And these are all in mice in that case, and I'll talk a little bit about that work, as well as in the treatment of heart disease, in particular in targeting to sites of myocardial infarction following heart attack, and those are done in rat models. I'm going to finish up by talking about some of the details and innovations we take in our group towards actually characterizing the materials that we make. Chemists and in terms of material scientists as well have made great strides in the development of strategies for preparing complex nanomaterials. I'll show some of the applications of those up front, but the other side of that coin is how you actually work out that you've made what you've indeed made. And I think these innovations on both of those sides need to occur, both the preparation and then application of the materials, in a reproducible way that has some function that can't be accessed otherwise, but also going in and actually figuring out new approaches to actually characterizing complex matter. And that's a lot of what our group worries about. Some of these areas of things I won't have time to talk about include new approaches to mimicking biological systems. We're very interested in things like melanin-based materials, for example. They have interesting magnetic properties. We are interested in how we might be able to use them as replacements, possibly as therapies or as cosmetics, for replacements of naturally occurring melanin. So these are essentially mimics, nanoparticles that mimic mimic organelles that are melanosomes that are produced naturally. That's just one example of the kind of natural sort of biomaterial that we're interested in. And as Skip sort of alluded to, we're also interested in completely synthetic systems. In some cases, programmed with biomolecules to do specific functions in vivo and respond to specific patterns of gene expression that results in patterns of protein and enzyme in the extracellular matrix of diseased tissues. And that's really what I'm going to talk about today in terms of targeting. So my group, moving from left to right here, looks a lot at, again, how to prepare and then characterize really complex matter. These don't look that complicated. This is a cryo-EM image of some of the nanoparticles that we use for targeting to tumors. In the central figure here, you can see some tumors lit up. This is actually a near-infrared image of two tumors that are identical that have been implanted in a xenograft mouse. This is an immune-deficient mouse that we use to model human cancer. On the right-hand side, and I'll talk a little bit about how these systems work, and on the far right-hand side is a cartoon, of course, of a heart, and then a real image of our particles accumulating within inflamed tissue immediately following MI. Now, many, many people are taking nanomedicine-type approaches to solving problems, in particular in cancer. And my title of this really touched on this idea that this is the major hurdle. Well, there are many hurdles, okay? And so certainly delivery is one of them. We have many ways of killing tissue, but we don't have very many ways of specifically killing specific tissue. There are very simple small molecules that will completely devastate and completely destroy all kinds of living tissue, for example, hydrofluoric acid. But you don't inject that intravenously without terrible results. So there are a lot of complex small molecules, either they derive from natural products, in the case of paclitaxel, which I'll talk about, or metal-based therapeutics. We work with cisplatin, for example, have published on that work, that work to act as cytotoxins, as well as some more advanced therapies, including small molecule immunotherapeutics, which our group has also worked on together with researchers in this building over here at UCSD. But in each of these cases, systemic delivery of whether they're cytotoxins or the immunotherapeutics can result in extremely deleterious effects, where the difference between whether the drug kills you and whether the drug helps you can be so narrow as to make them ineffective, or certainly enter in a regime where large portions of the patient population are non-responsive because you can't access doses that would result in a response without harming the patient beyond what they can tolerate. And so essentially we work on this principle then that there certainly is no magic bullet. And this harkens back to sort of many, many years of attempts to claim that we have them. Now, small molecules are selective to some degree. They select for certain proteins, for example, and they're designed that way. Or they select for certain tissues by design or not, in most cases not, because of biodistribution patterns that are governed by protein transporters that are built into particular tissues or particular cells within certain tissues. So, for example, the majority of FDA-approved drugs that have been properly analyzed hit all kinds of targets, many of them not part of the design process at all. And we're talking about protein-specific targets. So these are small molecules that lodge themselves into binding sites, either on the surface of blood proteins or specific proteins within cells or on the surface of cells. So small molecules can indeed be designed to some degree to hit certain transporters. Maybe they're designed to hit specific active sites of certain enzymes. Their outcome in terms of how they actually work in humans can be quite dramatically different from what we originally designed. And so one of our dream goals in this, and we don't do this now, we'd love to continue to do more of it, we don't do it very well, I should say, is to team up with people who are working on small molecule therapeutics or even biomolecular therapeutics and design carrier systems that complement them precisely. A lot of medicinal chemistry has been spent on trying to make molecules drug-like. In other words, injectable, bioavailable. But if you have a carrier that targets well, picks up particular transporters and particular tissues and have biodistribution patterns that are governed by the carrier system, then maybe the small molecule doesn't have to be as selective, or it can hit on different types of things. You can have, for example, a more toxic drug or one that is even more selective because you weren't worrying about how to get it across a cellular membrane, which is a traditional and huge expense in the industry. And so there's no magic bullet. How do we get to where we want to be? Essentially, what we want to do is we'll take a look at this graph. What we want to do is broaden this window. So we have a window between where you have efficacy. So this might be something like an effective dose. Between the effective dose and where the drug is no longer tolerated. So a maximum tolerated dose and a minimum effective dose. If that window is very, very narrow, you can imagine that you don't have a molecule that's safely injectable. If it's very, very broad, you have a large dose range that you can go into humans with, and certainly in more advanced therapies, for example, in combination with other drugs, we want to have a very broad therapeutic index so that we can find tolerated doses and effective doses for multiple drugs, sort of drug cocktail type approaches. So our efforts, both in the nanomaterials that I'll talk about, but also in some other things that I can't talk about, unfortunately, in public, we really do look at ways of broadening this therapeutic index such that we can dose large ranges of drugs. We have efficacy at very high doses, but also efficacy at very low doses. And I'll touch on some of the importance of that as I discuss this. So in the clinic today, there are several nanomedicines or nanomedicine type formulations that are present that you'll find in the clinic. Two of them are shown on the right-hand side. Doxil is a liposome that contains doxorubicin, essentially. These are really beautiful cryo electron microscopy images of liposomes. You can see that black ring is the outer edge of a lipid bilayer. Lipid bilayers and structures like this are found in cells. For example, endosomal compartments, they're naturally involved in encapsulating entire cells together with proteins, of course. The drug can be formulated, encapsulated inside, and you can see that in the cryo image here, nicely, that little band of doxorubicin or semicrystalline drug that's inside the particle. These are injected in vivo. The particles begin to break up. The liposome itself, because it essentially mimics natural cellular membranes, is capable, of course, of shearing and incorporating into cellular membranes that are present in the blood. The drug, of course, can then have pharmacokinetic profiles that look maybe slightly different, or in some cases, not in this particular case, but in some cases, very similar to the parent drug. The bottom example here is Abraxane. This is a human serum albumin-coated a nanoparticle of paclitaxel, and I'll talk about that drug today, the parent drug itself, paclitaxel. These are drugs that are cytotoxic in nature. They function via different mechanisms, doxorubicin and the paclitaxel. These are very common FDA-approved formulations and other formulations in their own rights. In these two cases, they happen to be nanoparticulate. Now, they work via proposed mechanisms that may or may not, in fact, function that way. These are quite complex things to actually work out. But essentially, I'll take an example of the bottom one, Abraxane. It was essentially approved for getting around, because it got around using some of the carriers, some of the toxic carriers that are associated with trying to make paclitaxel drug-like, trying to get it in solution so that you can intravenously inject it. There are all sorts of problems with actually just physically injecting it intravenously, the parent drug, and indeed Abraxane as well. This is essentially a colloidal suspension that looks like a milky white solution that over time precipitates in the over the time of use in the patients, and a lot of drug is wasted. You can get around certain toxicity at injection. If you talk to pharmacists, some of them don't like it, some of them do, some doctors like it, or some of them don't. But these are the types of formulations that exist. They, to varying degrees, do and don't solve the problems that are kind of highlighted on this left-hand figure. And that is, if you've got a lung tumor or breast tumor, you can also target these other organs. And these are the organs that are in the business in your body of clearing out nanoparticles and other things. But in nanomedicine in particular, there's a huge challenge. Because your body has spent billions of years trying to get rid of viruses, trying to get rid of artificial drugs, artificial toxins coming from the environment. In particular, you can imagine the problems in delivering things like nucleic acids. If your cells just took up any old nucleic acid, we'd be in trouble, right? So there's a lot of resistance from your tissues because of your ability to survive this world. For example, topical applications. You don't just get things randomly through your skin, and that's a good thing, mostly. So topical applications of drugs is very difficult to do. Even an intravenously injected nanoparticle mostly gets scavenged by your immune system, by white blood cells, and transported to these organs, either out through the kidneys, which is potentially a good thing, or it accumulates in the liver. It can accumulate and then clear via that process. It can cause liver toxicity. You can have other kinds of off-target toxicities in these organs. And those things compete with the toxicity to the tumor. And of course, this is an old story, right? Everybody's aware of this, and it's in the movies, right? That these cytotoxic drugs cause normal tissues to suffer while you're trying to treat them. The carrier systems are trying to shift that balance away from these other organs towards that tumor, and they've largely failed. Most things that have been studied have not made it to market. And I'm often told by my small molecule organic chemistry colleagues that there are many, many, many nanoparticles that haven't worked. Is nanomedicine a failure? Or they tell me nanomedicine is a failure. And the question is, why is that the case? Of course, my initial answer is, well, almost 100 years worth of small molecule research in medicine has also resulted in many failures. In fact, many, many more. So small molecule chemistry doesn't work just as badly as nanomedicine doesn't work. Now, the difference is the promise, right? Nanomedicine was meant to solve everything. And it hasn't. So where are the problems? Number one, I would argue, and this is a list of different things that are commonly discussed. Number one is that real human tumors don't perform like xenografts. They don't perform like human tumors that are implanted in immune-compromised mice, which is the model all of us use in the initial studies. Right? This is the flaming hoop we have to jump through, both in small molecule medicine applications and also in nanomedicine. And one of the things you see in nanomedicine is that the size of the nanoparticle, if you've got a sphere that's about 200 nanometers across, which is a virus scale kind of nanoformulation, they tend to accumulate within these tumors. These are poorly, well, somewhat vascularized, but poorly draining, poorly formed, really fake tumors inside and subcutaneous implants of human tumors in immune compromised mice. They're not very similar. They're sort of a step up from just looking at a tumor sort of nodule in a dish or a thin film in the case of in vitro cellular studies. So it's better than just doing in vitro cell studies, but it's nowhere near a real human tumor. And what those particles can do is they can exit the vasculature through these porous, poorly formed vessels. And that's the so-called EPR effect. It's sort of a leaky effect. the tumor is more leaky than other tissues, and so a big particle can get out into the tumor, but not out into normal tissues. And so targeting has kind of been just sort of, without actually looking at the mechanism, it's just, oh, it goes by the leaky effect. Now that works in some cases in the xenograft, but it doesn't translate all the time to large animals and to properly formed tumors, which unfortunately is what we suffer from. The other problem is that the tumors that we are really interested in is the ones that, of course, the small ones that we can't see, the metastasis sites. And so these can be, in that case, poorly vascularized. These are small, so-called micro metastases that we don't know where they are. We potentially can't image them. So you can resect, you can remove the primary tumor and then go on to not be capable of targeting to the mets. And so there are ways around this using the drugs themselves, in particular in the case of immunotherapies. But again, we have this targeting problem. How do I inject something that knows to home to these other tissues? How do we solve that issue? Now in our work, in this one example, and we don't have all those answers by any means. In our work, what we're interested in doing is going head to head with this particular nanoscale formulation. This drug, as I said, was mainly approved in our minds because of getting around having to carry with these toxic carriers the paclitaxel drug by using human serum albumin, which is the most abundant protein in the blood. These are real data from our lab. This is an example of a survival study, for those of you who are not familiar with it. These same kinds of plots are used to measure, you know, time to employment, for example. So here's day zero. We dose at the beginning, of course, everyone's alive, everyone's unemployed. And then we go along, and you can see here is the baseline. This is just a saline control. This is sort of standard kind of data. And you can see the animals dying over time, and you can see, you get an idea for how many animals in the group, and they die over time. They either actually die or they die because we put a benchmark limit on how big their tumors can get. And so that's what happens when you don't treat the animal. When you treat the animal with these kinds of doses, 300 milligrams per kilo of animal, this is a very, very high dose of Abraxane, you kill almost all the animals because of the drug. So anything to the left of that saline line could be thought of as drug toxicity. You go down to 50 milligrams per kilo. In this mouse model, this HD1080 model, again, most of the animals die before the saline, and this little guy lives out past the 50 days and then dies, just past the other saline animal. So essentially, for these two doses, if you're in the clinic, you would much rather just not be treated. At least you wouldn't be sick. You would go about your business. In fact, you wouldn't have died before the average person would have died without treatment. And that's kind of how you want to read that. At 5 mg per kg, no animals die within the study from the drug. But you can see you get very little benefit in terms of survival. Now, what's not shown here is that about 15 to 20 milligrams per kilo does quite well. Several of the animals still die before saline, but we live out for many, many, a couple of months. So half the population kind of go down because of the drug. But if you survive the drug, you go on to be cured in some cases. And this is sort of the common sort of outlook. And again, I said that the xenograft mouse is not a good model. I mean, in a sense, it is if you look at the outcomes. This is sort of what we're fighting. What we want to do is treat with a drug that hits up here, of course, that doesn't look anything like saline. The drug's not toxic, and the animals survive out for a long period of time. So we went about addressing this problem of targeting via taking a completely new approach. And what we did was look at soap for inspiration. Now, again, that's exactly like the doxyl formulation. It's basically made of lipids, right? These lipids are kind of like soaps. They dissolve hydrophobic things inside them, and on the outside we have hydrophilic things like water. In the case of the liposomes that doxyl has, they have this film, which is hydrophilic on the outside, hydrophilic on the inner leaflet, and then the drug sits inside the water. And that's why it's sort of precipitated in that, because it's hydrophobic, or it's held in that state by depending on some other conditions. Now, the particles can take all kinds of shapes. Basically, this is the oldest kind of surfactant in the book. It's present in your cells. You're alive, basically, because of these processes. But basically, these are small molecule surfactants. They have hydrophilic head groups, hydrophobic tails. In this case, it's kind of a cartoon of a standard kind of fatty acid. Maybe it's a carboxylic head group and a C18 chain. Palmitic acid is an example of one of these things, for example. They'll pack together to exclude water into a specific shape. Now, if you add two tails to the same kind of head group, you can make a lamellar surface, because basically what you have is a whole lot of closely packed cylinders that make a flat sheet. as those cylinders become more and more cone-shaped, they get higher surface curvatures. And so what people had looked at before we got into this business was all kinds of stimuli. So these might be things like light. Maybe you shine some light on a liposome that's made of these. You have a light-sensitive group that connects the chain to the head group. The light breaks that leg off, so the surfactant kind of looks like this one. And what you would see if you were good enough at doing electron microscopy is a whole lot of liposomes breaking up and dispersing as little spheres. Now, your organisms do this all the time, and they can manipulate membranes using protein interactions and a whole range of things. What we were interested in doing was designing surfactant-based systems, basically very, very expensive soaps, that change their shape depending on what kinds of enzymes interact with their surfaces. And I'll show you what they look like. But this is the outcome we were looking for. The goal was to make a material that you can intravenously inject, and in the best case scenario, this would be a very low molecular weight, maybe a low molecular weight small molecule that isn't even recognized as a nanoparticle by your immune system, for example. We haven't achieved that, but that would be sort of the extreme example. Or a very small particle. And these would be particles 8 nanometers or less, potentially neutrally charged, that are capable of exiting out of the kidneys really quickly upon injection, so that your immune system doesn't have much time to recognize them and take them to the liver. Now, the other goal here is to get as minimum number of injections as possible. So a lot of what we've done with these particular cases are single injections. But the idea is you inject intravenously, we get fast circulation times throughout the body. But what happens is these little tiny particles are able to get out, and they're able to get out into lots of different tissues. They're small enough to do this. In the xenograft animal, as I mentioned, the tumor is also leaky. So the particles tend to get out. Now, because they're leaky, the tumors are actually pretty good at pumping the particles back into the bloodstream. That's where a lot of nanoparticles also fail. Even if they've got little ligands on the surface, little modifications that let them Velcro to tissues, they don't have the time to Velcro, to attach, and they just pump right back into the vasculature. And so you get very poor accumulation. And most things fail because of those two reasons. Either they don't actually get out into the vasculature, or once they do, they just get pumped back in. And chemical engineers will tell you that this is gonna be the case, right? I've got a fast flowing pump here, or a fast flowing stream, and I'm trying to have something exit and not come back in by things like a vacuum force. Okay, the pressure inside the tissue and the flow. So what we did was design a particle that would, as I said here, undergo a shape change. These would undergo a dramatic change in their morphology in response to signals from inside the tumors. And these are signals that are not completely specific, but they're signals that come from enzymes that are upregulated by the inflammatory response. And these are enzymes that are known, for example, cutting up all of the material, the collagen that holds together your cells and tissues. These are present within tumors, in some cases, in lots of cases. The cells are being cut free by these enzymes. They're entering into the bloodstream and they're distributing throughout the body, and then they're sort of using those same enzymes in some cases to eat their way into other tissues. So you go from a breast cancer to a lung metastasis, for example, via that kind of process. There are lots of signals involved. The enzyme itself is one of the most dramatic because it's actually an enzyme, like a catalyst being expressed into the tissue and sort of amplifying its own presence, right? It's able to cut many, many strands of collagen. Our particles mimic the extracellular matrix. They mimic that material, that protein-based material that's holding your tissue together. When they exit, the enzymes work on their surface to unravel them. And they unravel like balls of twine. They stick to each other and they stick to the ECM and they stick to cells and they implant themselves. So what we've done essentially is make a gel type material that actually has similar properties to the extracellular matrix that was naturally there. The rest of the material, the part that's responsive, is obliterated by these enzymes. The rest carries a drug. And over time that drug hydrolyzes and essentially is like having a depot. You have a depot of drug within the tissue itself that then gets to therapeutic doses and kills off the tissue. And I'll show you how this works in this context and also in heart attack. Following heart attack, your heart produces the same sorts of enzymes. And I'll show you some dramatic images that can illustrate what your heart looks like after a heart attack. If you're so inclined, you can close your eyes if you don't like. Mm-hmm. Okay. These are cryo-TEM images, again, of the kinds of particles I'm talking about. If there are any chemists in the room, this is the kind of polymer platform we use. We also use a range of other kinds of polymers, and we've published on several of these now. Basically, again, what they are is just those surfactants, hydrophobic tails with hydrophilic head groups. But the hydrophilic head group is a peptide being a short sort of fragment of a protein. And that protein sequence that we pick is a substrate, or it's recognized as a mimic of collagen or of the extracellular matrix itself. When the enzyme cuts it, the particles begin to become destabilized. Their surfaces are no longer able to protect the core of the particle from water, and the particles begin to fuse together. And what you can't see probably from where you're sitting, these are models that we've generated from some videos we can take using electron microscopy that I'll talk about, that show the sort of first step in particle destabilization and particle fusion. And we spend a lot of time worrying about specific things like that. These are what these kinds of systems look like when they have drug. Again, we've got some chemistry here, but basically this is our soap. Hydrophobic region, which is gonna be all drug. So that about 65, and in some cases 70% of the weight of these polymers and the particles they make is drug. These are massive loadings. You can't achieve that with other kinds of methods, and that's some details to do with how we do the chemistry. As we make the particles, they're little spheres. After the enzymes react with them, they make them unstable, and they begin to fuse to each other. And they make these gel-type materials that then serve as, this depot of drug. This is how the actual chemistry looks. If there are any chemists, we actually made these things. So I like to show this slide. This is the drug. That's paclitaxel. This is a natural product. It's produced through a semi-synthesis. It's one of the most famous cancer drugs. If any of you have had chemotherapy or know people, you may very well have come across it. It is one of the traditional sort of, more prosaic sort of cytotoxins. It works in some cases. Now, this is an animal model, and this is another example of a kind of study you might do. This is a short-term one, but this kind of gives you a feel for what we sort of do. It says healthy animals. These are actually immune-compromised mice who just haven't, they don't have a tumor. And we do these same sort of studies in tumor-burdened animals as well. So here's day zero. Here's its weight. Of course, they're 100% of their normal weight at the beginning of the series of injections. In this case, it's a single injection. As I said, we try to stick with that for these nanoparticles. The clinical formulation of paclitaxel is this nasty formulation I talked about. Upon intravenous injection, the mice very often lose their tails. These can't be injected very safely like this through human skin, for example, and there's all sorts of methods for getting around it. That's not depicted in this plot. So these animals look like they're doing okay based on their body weight. In other words, they do okay, right? Here's the clinical formulation. In fact, they gain a bit of weight. Our formulation, this is our nickname for our particle. This is a particle carrying all this drug that's sort of primed up, ball of twine to target to the tissue. In this case, there's no tumor. We do the injection at the same dose as the parent drug. Nothing happens. Safely injectable, which is a nice outcome, but nothing happens. If we go up to what is the known LD50, these are doses that are basically going to be poisonous to the animal. And indeed at 30 milligrams per kilo, so these are 30 milligrams per with respect to the drug of the animal's weight, so it's a tiny amount of drug, injected intravenously, again, all the animals in that cohort die. And we obviously didn't go above that dose after that. Again, these are small scale studies, but this tells us we can do huge doses. We can go above 300 milligrams per kilo. We can get up to the range of 400 to 500 if we do these injections in other sort of body cavities other than intravenously. So these are very big doses of drug. Now, this is not uncommon for nanomedicine, and a lot of things fail now because you've basically put drug inside a particle. You may as well not have injected it. That's the next question, right? You've made it non-toxic, which means it's not toxic to the animal. That's great. And the next study, of course, you better prove that it works at the low dose, because otherwise you've just killed the drug. In other words, we've modified this drug in a way that makes it ineffective. And in fact, we know parts of that molecule that are blocked by our chemistry that actually should make it ineffective. So this basically says you've made a particle that's dead. And the fact is that it works at low dose as well. This is just a small slice of a survival study here where all the saline animals are still alive at 14 days in this case. We're comparing it now to Abraxane, that's sort of a normal head-to-head, plus the normal formulation that's used much more frequently in the clinic. These are about $9 billion drugs total. That's sort of the market so they're used a lot. Our formulation at the same dose works exactly the same way. as you can imagine, we now have studies ongoing looking at, well, what happens when you dose at 240 or 300 milligrams per kilo? Do you enter a new sort of manifold of reactivity? Is this useful in combination with other kinds of small molecules? And that's the kind of direction we're going in. Now, Abraxane itself is well marketed. It makes a lot of money. The paclitaxel, as I mentioned, is common, right? So this was a good test case for us, but probably not translatable, not for this particular drug. And we've moved into other kinds of drugs now, including some biomolecules and some immunotherapeutics that we haven't yet published on. But this kind of gives you an idea. This was sort of our first choice in this case. In addition, I think cancer is obviously of great interest to us. There's a big unmet need in terms of, I think, certainly better targeting. I think addressing problems where, for example, you can't target certain tumors with the small molecule itself. So how do you change between tissue types using carriers? These are the kinds of questions we're worried about now, in addition to moving into other types of diseases. That's where the MI work became interesting. And what we went after with Karen Christman, who's a professor in bioengineering at UCSD and in fact works in SCRM right here. What we got into with Karen was saying, let's go after a disease and a particular state of this disease where there currently is no therapeutic, where we would be first in class. And I think Skip would also appreciate that, right? Let's move out of where there's a big clustered field and into something where there's simply no other solution. And so we got interested in this. And it also, Karen came to me actually at an NIH conference and said, we work in this area. And I said, yeah, I know. Sort of met in Washington instead of here and started working together. And basically one of the first things was to look at things like enzyme expression. It was known and sort of the literature varies on this, but it's known in general that these same inflammatory enzymes are overexpressed. And so you may have heard this, right? These different diseases are really inflammatory diseases, whether it's in this case or in the case of the cancer. In this case, this is sort of the result of disease, right? You've actually had a heart attack at this point because of ongoing, maybe bad habits in terms of how you and I eat, or at least me. Okay, so what you've had is a blockage in an artery that's feeding your heart muscle tissue oxygen, which is bad to begin with, and then it reperfuses. The blockage comes free potentially. You survive this heart attack, blood pumps back into that location, and in this case, as shown, the left ventricle, and then you go on to live, but poorly in most cases. And so you have an initial infarction, again, in this location around the left ventricle. This then inflammatory response sets off a cascade of things that essentially, one of the things, and I'll show you some micrographs in a second, involves the obliteration of that tissue. And one of the big upregulated things are these enzymes that we're going to target to that mimic collagen. And so the cells are being cut free. Your body is essentially trying to form a scar. Now, if you're playing tennis and that scar is forming in this muscle, who cares? Stop playing or put it in a sling. But your heart doesn't do that, right? It doesn't stop playing. It keeps playing tennis every day. And it gets strained and strained and strained to the point where you have this global remodeling process, in some cases very quickly. Basically, your heart ceases to be a pump. Right now you've got this thin wall and this process has gone awry. Quite a natural process, right? But you just don't want it to happen in your heart. So what we wanted to do was come in at this step. We didn't want to wait a week. We don't want to wait hours. We don't want to wait days. We want to take patients right at that time when they have the heart attack and are resuscitated and be able to inject them with a material. Now, no one's ever going to let you inject that material directly into the heart tissue. It'll cause potentially another MI. And that's true, in fact, in the animal models as well. What you need to be able to do is inject somewhere else. And like any good drug, you want to be able to inject intravenously, maybe orally, but of course, in this case, it's an emergency, boom, straight in the artery. What we want to do is inject a material that's not a gel, right? It's nothing like a gel material that could hold the heart tissue together because it would form a gel at the point of injection and cause a clot and kill you. So you have to be able to inject something intravenously that's going to become gel-like inside the heart tissue. So you're basically replacing the extracellular gel material, your collagen material, inside the heart using an artificial implant. Karen actually works on some decellularized pig matrix materials that are actually in human trials now. And again, she's a colleague of mine here at UCSD. That's administered later on, right? Later on down this track. What she wanted to do was come in really early. And this was, and there's some several papers here referenced at the bottom if you're interested, but basically there's several routes you could go down. all of which involve injecting materials into the heart. What we wanted to do was go after this holy grail, as Karen first described it to me, using this other approach. So what we did was make some more soaps. Now you can sort of squint at this a bit, but basically this is a diagram that came from one of our initial publications, where we're basically saying, I want to inject something that starts off as a little sphere, a little nanoscale ball, or even better, just a small polymer. It circulates freely in this form and then aggregates into this gel-type material that matches the ECM, matches this kind of gel-like material. Now it works quite nicely in a laboratory setting like this, where we're doing pristine imaging. It also happens to work in the animals. And this is really exciting. We got the first paper out now, I guess a year and a half ago, a couple of years ago now. And we've now moved on to doing many, many more studies. And this gives you an example of that. This is a rat heart that's cut through this way as a slice. You can see the left ventricle here. This is healthy tissue. This is a massive heart attack that surrounds that left ventricle. You saw from that other orientation, this would be like going completely under the base and around. This is in 3D. This is just a tissue slice. Now this is stained red and blue. The nuclei of these cells are blue, and the bodies of these, you can see the myocardiocytes, the heart muscle tissue, nicely pink in this false color, well, dyed image. Okay, so here's the scar. Now, if you could zoom in on there, which you can do with the microscope, you would see little blue dots, and that's the white blood cells. That's white blood cells that have flushed into that area, just like you get in a cut in your hand that fills with that white fluid. You've got white blood cells going there to begin the process of scar formation. And of course, the removal of other kinds of debris and things like that. Now, what that means is that the tissue's inflamed. The vessels have actually become porous, naturally, not because of an implantation of an artificial xenograft. You remember I said the xenograft's not a good model because it's a poorly formed tumor. It's got these porous vessels that may or may not really mimic real human cancers. Well, this isn't a real rat heart. What we did was surgically block it. We didn't feed it poorly for, you know, 60 years. We blocked its artery and then released it. So we mimic that effect, but it sets off a cascade that's very similar to what we see, including the vasculature itself becoming more porous. White blood cells flood in and begin to obliterate the red cells. And what you're gonna see on the next slide is a little video of the next slice down. So we take the other 10 micron slice, dye it green, and our particles are going to be in red, and you're going to see the blue cells. This is a little zoom in. This movie kind of moves along quite nicely. So you can see this is normal tissue. Again, nice heart tissue. There was no heart attack on this side. Left ventricle, massive heart attack. And you'll see we'll turn off some channels here. My student Andrea made this video for us from the micrograph itself. We'll turn off these green channels and the blue, and you'll see our red particles, hopefully really beautifully, inside the infarction. So these particles have localized and stuck in the infarction. The tissue is still porous at this point when the animal is sacrificed. So a normal particle, in fact, there are particles in literature that will exit the vasculature, they'll get into this space and then pump back out. So you have very inefficient targeting. You certainly don't accumulate a three-dimensional material, which is what we're actually doing here. Now, I should say, these materials don't do anything at all. They just carried a dye in this case. They got there, so we high-fived each other and published it. But the real challenge is, do we have any efficacy? And so what we want to do now is carry on what we are carrying on doing, and as you can imagine, proper efficacy studies take some time, to look at whether or not indeed we're able to heal the heart and prevent that remodeling process using this approach. And of course, that's a big question. But the real challenge, the initial challenge at least, was can you target there via this completely new method? Again, to access something, unlike cancer, that can't be addressed by other methods. Now, I've run out a little bit of time, but I'm going to show you one thing while I'm here. I've talked a lot about this, right? This is the mechanism by which our materials work. And this was a known mechanism, right? What we did was innovate by making biomolecules into the triggering system, into the stimulus, so that these materials would interface with specific enzymatic signals instead of, say, the change of pH, which is like the change in the concentration of protons in solution, or other non-informational stimuli like change of temperature. What we did was say, okay, can we have materials that undergo fundamental changes in their morphology in response to very specific biochemical signals? So we've done this with nucleic acids. I've talked about it today in the context of proteins and enzymes in particular. But nevertheless, these are really interesting materials in general. Because as I said, your cells, paints, all kinds of materials use systems like this. Now, in particular, then these particles are generally called micelles. They come in all sorts of forms, vesicular structures, tubular little structures, all kinds of little chambers, including traditional micelles, where basically this is how you would clean your clothes, right? Dissolve grease in the middle, dissolve water on the outside, and transport greasy stains out of your shirt. And in fact, that is how that chemistry works. So we got interested in the fundamental chemistry of this because, of course, we were in the business of making complex materials and injecting it in vivo. We've had, for many years now, in parallel, a big synthetic effort, which I haven't talked about, but also a big effort in characterization. I'll show you some of that. Basically, particles as made can do all kinds of dynamic things that had never been captured directly. There's a lot of indirect evidence for nanoscale phenomena that I think is one of the biggest reasons why we don't innovate more in the area. It's not because you can't make complex materials, it's because it's very difficult to tell what you've made. Nuclear magnetic resonance, as well as X-ray crystallography, are the reason why we have modern medicine. Not the synthetic method follows in some sense, because if I can't tell you what I've made, there's no point making it. So these things have happened in tandem, but the enabling tool is always the characterization tool. Right? That's how we have modern materials, because we can figure out what we've made. And what we got interested in is looking at dynamics. And so transmission electron microscopy and similar methods for looking at nanoscale features have been around for many years. One of the biggest missing things was our ability to image things in motion. There's a lot of good reasons why that hasn't been developed. This is what I showed you before. These are cryo-TEMs. This is where you've taken a particle and frozen it in non-crystalline or vitreous ice. Okay, and then you're imaging through a thin film of ice. You put it sort of on the end of a knife, in a sense, like a little pole that you stick into the electron column. See, the electrons are generated in the column, they go through some lenses, they hit your sample and you take an image of it. And these are always static images, right? You take a static image like this, they're frozen in ice, so they are considered to be similar to what they were in solution. Although you can see they're very highly organized, they're not like this in solution, right? Particles don't float around in a block and they're certainly not concentrated enough. So they're artificially frozen. And in many cases, people don't do cryo-EM, they actually take the particles and stain them with something like uranyl acetate, a uranium type stain that basically blocks electrons really efficiently so that you can image. Now, this is good. I mean, this is a really good image taken by one of my grad students, but it's not dynamic. It's absolutely frozen. And what I've been talking about is particles that get injected, they circulate, they exit tissues. We've got a lot of other data to prove that that happens. But the very fundamental thing of even watching a destabilized particle undergo that first step in morphology transition had never been done. And we got interested in why and how we might do this. Now, I don't like using Feynman quotes in nano talks because it's been done to death, but I do rekindle this one because I think, I hope he would have liked this. And the idea is he said, look, just look at it. And he was talking about electron microscopy. Just take a photo of the material, right? And as electron microscopy is being developed, this is how we've characterized a lot of different materials. Just photograph it. And what we wanted to move was beyond photography towards videography. So you imagine instead of watching a Grand Prix race or a soccer match or an NFL game through a series of freeze frame photos, you'd watch a video of it. It's revolutionary. We've been able to do that for over 100 years in other contexts, but not in the context of materials. And so what we've done, and this part of this is commercial and part of it isn't, some of it's a result of some inventions we've done here, is take these kinds of chips. And basically what you do is you assemble a little nanoscale cell, a little nanoscale solution cell. Some of you would be aware of cuvettes that people use in UV-Vis, or tubes people use for NMR. You sort of contain a material somewhere and then look at it. And in this case, what you do is you sandwich some water, a thin film of water, between two plates. And these are very small dimensions, and you can see the dimensions drawn here in terms of the window. What happens is the electrons are going to come through that window, through our sample, and we're going to video them moving around, hopefully. It's a very two-dimensionally constrained system. It's not absolutely perfect. It's like watching great white sharks swimming around in this room, right? They don't have absolute ability to dive in the Z direction, but certainly you could learn a lot by observing them in a small tank, in a thin tank. This setup looks like this. I'll show you a little video. This is my student, Molly, who took this, and you'll see her hands in here. This is the little piece. She's going to sit down. This is the piece that's going to go into the microscope, and the very tip of that, the beam is going to go through it. She's putting a sample on here by hand. This is being dropped onto that bottom, what we call the bottom chip. What she's going to do is she's going to put the top one on really carefully, and she's going to line up by eye these two windows, which are very small microscale windows. She's going to seal it shut, and then she's going to check that it's holding a vacuum. Basically, the electron beam is going to exit a high vacuum. It's going to enter this thin film of water, and then it's going to enter a high vacuum again and then hit the camera. And so, and basically, you don't want the little ravioli that you made out of silicon nitride to burst in the microscope. So she's showing you, here's how beautiful it looks. She then puts this into a vacuum test system, and she's going to use a microscope to look down the microscope to see that the particles, not the particles in it, the windows are intact. She pumps this up to the, or down to the vacuum that the microscope's at normally. I don't understand how they videoed this, but they did it. And you can see this is the little window. That's that microscale window through the through this aperture here. And we're going to image through it. So your electrons are going to go through just like my laser pointer. Here's the microscope, gets inserted in the side. We can flow materials in, and we can take videos of particles forming. This actually comes from a video on looking at some porous materials from our published work. What we've done and what Skip's helped us do in collaboration with a company, it's a German company, Cynian, is develop a tool for doing what she just did by hand using a robotic system. And what the robot will do is take, these are picoliter dispensing tools that'll spot down multiple samples on a grid so that we can start doing chemical reactions. And we've actually done this and published on it now. We have the very first paper ever, together with some guys at Northwestern University, of actually doing chemical reactions in the transmission electron microscope for the first time. You notice that she did it with a hand. She kind of, this is that top window she picked up at the end, and I said she had to line up. This is now done by a robot that has a camera on it that can see the windows themselves, which means we can make the windows a lot smaller and do these kinds of techniques. Okay, so what actually happens? This is the kind of video we're able to get. This is just extraordinary. This is probably the 100th time I've watched it, but this is amazing to me. These are actual micelle particles, the type that we've been injecting, undergoing fusion. You see those two fused together? This is them undergoing particle-particle fusion events. We see multiple particle fusion events, fission events. These are the kinds of interactions and reactions that occur in cellular systems, in colloidal suspensions, in paints, and things like that all the time, and have never been captured before, certainly not in video. So my lab cares a great deal about these mechanisms, and we've worked a lot on this. You'll see these videos here of other particles kind of colliding and doing things. With a fundamental understanding of how matter works at this length scale, in tandem with your ability to synthesize things as a chemist, and then sort of, you know, an interest in how this may translate to human disease, in particular, I think, for these particular particles in heart disease, I think we really have something interesting, again, enabled a great degree by our collaborators that I've mentioned here, graduate students who've done the work, people like Skip and the office here who've let us actually protect the inventions, and not just these, but many, many others, including 15 that we just dumped on his desk this morning, or in the last 2 days. And so thank you very much. Again, some of their names are up here, some of my collaborators as well. This is a photo of my group at a Christmas party, actually from last year, having some fun, and the institutions that fund us, so thank you.
One, two. That was fantastic. Before we get into the Q&A sessions, I wanted to give you an idea of who your audience is. And I see a number of, a number of people who are investors and entrepreneurs here in the audience. Those of you who are entrepreneurs or investors, can you please raise your hands? We got quite a few of them in the audience. So those of you who are students, could you please raise your hands? Very good. Are there any faculty in here? Nope. Very good. So it's a nice mix. I just want to also introduce a special guest that we have that we're going to introduce after the Q&A session. And I'm going to start by saying, you know, Nathan just communicated to us using slides, but also his voice, the content of the research and the impact that his research is having. And I think we all could hear the excitement, the sense of urgency, and the sense of wonder in the tone that he used in how he communicated to us. One of our guests tonight that is going to speak for a couple of minutes after our Q&A session is Carl Martens, who is here. And he's an actor, a musician, and also an expert in communication. So he's going to be talking to us for a couple of minutes about that. Great. Questions. Let's take questions from the audience, please.
Maybe I needed
And don't
those,
be shy.
I needed those lessons before my talk.
You don't need a thing, you have an accent.
Oh.
That makes you sound far more sophisticated.
Any questions?
I could also tell there are investors here because I saw a lot of skepticism.
Yeah, hi. So, these particles are kind of big, you know, 20 nanometers. Is there any, like, computational model that you're using to try to visualize it in that regard?
In visualizing how big?
Visualizing, I don't know, either a Brownian motion simulation or molecular dynamics.
Really good question. Yeah. The particles you could see in the videos were some of them on different length scales. Some of the videos, well, that one in particular, they've undergone fusion reactions already. So in this video, for example, which may not play now, I'll just leave it in case I mess up. Oh, there we go. You can see little ones and some bigger ones that have undergone different steps in. So the model that I showed originally is actually a coarse grain model that has explicit water in it. And what we're doing there is simulating, based on knowledge of the aggregate number, the kinds of morphologies that we expect. And actually, the in silico model nicely matches entrainment of water and things like that. So they're large and they're expensive calculations. We've done those in collaboration with Juan de Pablo's group at University of Chicago. He did the simulations. On diffusion data, it's really interesting. So we've got, obviously, particles diffusing. We don't have as many frames per second as we want. We obviously want to be doing nanosecond frame rate imaging. So we're limited a little bit to looking at subdiffusive processes, but we see some interesting processes and we can prove essentially that we're subdiffusive Brownian. We can get conditions where we use dose rates where we actually trap the particles at the interface using what we think are static issues and charging issues at the interface. But we can get to conditions by analyzing things like diffusive motion based on short lag time analyses. We can get to conditions that we think would closely mimic what's happening in solution. I should say on the particles that we inject, I showed a range of things, but generally we move towards particles that are sub 10 nanometers in diameter for those studies. But you can imagine that's very hard to do at low dose rate in electron microscopy. Basically, as you go to higher and higher magnification, you go to higher and higher dose rate. In other words, the material is being absolutely pummeled and you're destroying the data, the data for sure. You're destroying the materials during the observation. So we're limited a little bit in resolution. So you're kind of artificially filtering out some of the smaller interactions.
Thank you.
I have a question while the public thinks about some of the ones that they may have. What about using nanoparticles to target existing calcium deposits in the artery? Is anybody working on that? Is there any way you can use any kind of material to Velcro, like to use the term that you use, into calcium deposits and then through some chemical reaction or otherwise eliminate the calcium deposits existing?
I don't know offhand of any nano solution for that. There are certainly drugs and other kinds of invasive processes for doing that. I don't know of a nanomedicine. There are lots of different systems. I wouldn't be shocked if there is, but I don't know of that. There are groups at UCSD who have looked at Bob Matry, who you may know, for example, and others of his collaborations have looked at targeting two blood clots, for example, and breaking them apart. And those types of approaches were sort of targeted ultrasound type therapies, sort of interventional sort of ultrasound type things where you could both image and then crank up the power and break apart blood clots. So maybe there's something like that, but not that I'm exactly aware of.
Questions? I know you guys have questions. Don't be shy.
That was a very interesting talk. With regards to you said that you introduced the polymers, and when you inject them, they don't bind to each other, right? But they bind together and form that gel-like material once it enters the heart. So what is it about, is there some sort of like biomarker or something in the heart where they then form together?
So what happens, so the particles are very, very stable. just in solution. They, in fact, I showed in one of the images the particles, some of the sort of micelle evolution processes. Those things occur when the particles are somewhat potentially unstable, either thermodynamically or kinetically, right? There's lots of different processes. And what we see for the ones we use in vivo, they don't ever fuse together. They don't undergo these reactions unless you stimulate them, unless you shear them, sonicate them, heat them a lot, or throw enzymes at them. And what those processes are doing is either enabling a particle, in the case of a physical stress like shear, they're enabling particles to go downhill thermodynamically into a fused state. In the case of the particles that we use in vivo, you're actually chemically altering the interface. So for example, you may go from a neutrally charged surface to a cationic surface. That's one way, sort of a cheap way of doing it, or anionic, or maybe two different particle populations have opposite charges. So lots of ways that people have kind of initiated those processes. In our case, what happens is the spherical phase itself is held in that phase because it's trying to exclude as much water from the hydrophobic core as it can. It's a purely entropic effect, basically of keeping water as disordered and as outside of that particle as you can, so that the core is kind of a glassy core. In fact, the transition temperature, so these are very stable particles. They don't just exchange pieces with each other. We know that from a lot of different studies. But when the shell gets cut by these enzymes that are chopping up, they're going around chopping up collagen. They start chopping up the surface of the particle. That phase, the spherical phase, is no longer the optimal phase for excluding water from the core. And they start fusing to each other. When they fuse, they undergo this phase transition. So the lowest energy phase that prevents as much water from accessing the core as it can is a more lamellar film-like gel. That's how we understand the phase transition.
So these enzymes are present in the heart and not in other areas? Oh,
okay. Well, they are present elsewhere. There are collagenases, for example, constantly active in your cartilage. And we do see some off-target accumulation in places like that. Which is why the heart disease model is interesting, right? It's a really serious problem that's serious right now. So if there's a bit of off-target accumulation, maybe it's not such a big thing. But those are considerations. It's known about the enzyme being expressed elsewhere. And of course, there's some concentration leaking into the blood. So like I said, there's no magic bullet, right? You're trying to get targeting to a biomarker that's potentially present elsewhere. What's interesting with enzymes is that they're enzymatically active, and within the tissue, it's within a confined space. So you have an artificial sort of effective concentration effect that we believe is contributing to the accumulation.
So do you think that this in the future, since you said that there was some offhand targeting into the cartilage, that it could be used as like a potential arthritis treatment in the future?
Good question. I'm going to say yes. But in fact, there are other challenges. But we definitely see it. In fact, in these animals, you may even be able to see it, actually. You can see in the backbone here. You can see it lit up. You can see some brightness in the skin, actually, from where the animals, these are xenograft animals, they bump up against the walls. And they get just enough inflammation in the skin. And these dyes are good enough. These are near-infrared dyes that are really clear against background, that we see it. You can actually see some in lymph nodes. One of the challenges is lymph node imaging. This is non-specific, so it's not good. Actually, I shouldn't show that. Just pretend that didn't happen. But you do see it in joints. And in fact, other kinds of MMP substrates that people have looked at, Roger Chen's work at UCSD, those things have similar kinds of effects like that. He also had done some work, and his lab has done some work on looking at more specific substrates. So we use a substrate that's an enzyme for multiple types of these enzymes. And you can narrow that down a little bit using some other kinds of optimization.
Also, as a side note, I was in your organic chemistry class a few 2 years back. I was wondering why you didn't have this presentation back then.
I'll tell you, I have over the years, sometimes I've chosen to tell undergrads that I do this research, and I'll spend part of the first lecture doing it. And some years I haven't. And it's mixed. Sometimes I'll get reports that say, the students give us reviews. And they'll write stuff like, oh, never told us he did any research. What's the story? Then the next year I'll do it and they'll say, all he cares about is research. He's a terrible teacher. So your year was my experiment, maybe the other way, so I don't know.
Right over here. Let me get your microphone.
may not need the mic, but thank you. Your lecture is fascinating. You've proven that you can get the gel-like material in the matrix into the area of the damaged tissue. Have you considered bringing to bear at the site of the myocardial infarct angiogenic materials that would help promote reperfusion of the damaged muscular tissue?
Yeah, so we're looking at a number of different small molecule and also biomolecule based drugs that do different things. And so that's one of them. Just a straight out normal anti-inflammatory is another drug we're looking at. Some of these were in trials and failed because of potential targeting problems. For example, some of the inhibitors of some of these processes also cause joint problems. Sure. Because they inhibit those enzymes. So yeah, we're looking at a range of that's exactly, you're exactly spot on. That's really what we want to do. There are some really nice peptides, for example, that call and cause differentiation of stem cells into a range of tissues. And so can you think about sort of a pattern of trying to kickstart or help the healing process? There are some fragments of collagen itself that have recently been shown to actually aid in that process. And our particles, of course, could potentially produce those same fragments, which are peptide-based fragments, that are also involved. So we're going down those routes.
I just one quick final question. You mentioned that you had done work with biologics and antibodies, and I know you can't tell us what you haven't published yet, but can you give us an insight into what kind of effects, what kind of results are you seeing with biologics and other drugs?
Yeah, so, well, one of the systems we use actually doesn't
with that specifics.
Yeah, one of the systems we're really interested in, it sort of flips it on its head. It doesn't use an antibody per se. It uses some natural metabolites and also normal proteins actually to aid in targeting to inflammation, let's say. Not by this mechanism, by a different mechanism. And in that case, it involves formulation with proteins. They can be small molecule drugs and also others. And that works incredibly well. And this was sort of an idea we had to kind of piggyback on natural targeting systems. And there are a few of these kinds of things that are known out there. And other labs are looking at some of these things. But the idea is to kind of mask drugs or materials or in some cases biomolecules as normal metabolites. And this is kind of a general concept to some extent. And what we've done is kind of couple that with protein-based systems as transporters as well. That's pretty vague. But in that case, these are really nice. And what we've noticed with that system is, because it's almost like piggybacking on and coupling with natural processes, you get incredibly good targeting, very low toxicities. You don't see as much liver accumulation and off-target as you do with nanoparticles, because these are not nanoparticles. They kind of avoid that entire problem by being completely different types of materials. And so that's kind of interesting to us, to kind of play with the nanomedicine type approach as maybe a way to accumulate materials differently than what other people have tried, retain materials differently, but then also a whole portion of my group just forget it, doing it entirely and do something totally new. So that's where we've gone with that. With antibodies, we have done some things with co-delivery. So we might take antibodies, for example, that are known to be effective in some way and couple them with our drugs. But we don't develop those as new things. We are working with some collaborators who have some unique targeting antibodies, but we kind of take their system and couple it with ours so that we get two sort of synergistic effects in targeting. We have no data to suggest that that's going to work yet. But there's good reason to do some of these things to get around some of the problems we have in leaving the vasculature selectively in cases where the tumor isn't actually porous. That's actually going to be a big direction for us now. We've sort of solved, in a sense, if you believe me, we've kind of maybe got a pathway to solving the retention problem. So we were able to retain materials in the tissue. But getting out of the vasculature into real tumors is very difficult for us. So we're kind of teaming up with different groups to solve that issue in that case. In vitro, we've looked at, and this is in cells, we've looked at some new interesting peptide-based drugs. Instead of using small molecules, which my group finds really interesting, we have some new approaches to carrying peptides. One of the big problems with peptide-based drugs is They clear very rapidly because they're low molecular weight oligopeptides, so they're not full proteins. So they're cleared quickly because they're small molecular weight, and they also degrade quickly. We have some polymeric scaffolds that effectively increase their molecular weight and also make them resistant to proteolysis. And that's going to be a big push for us in the next 4 or 5 years. Right now, we have really limited efficacy data. It's more like we can prove that they circulate longer and factors like that that are important in general rather than specifically.
Fantastic. Any more questions? No? Well, thank you very much for the 15 new cases that you put on Skip's desk this morning. I only asked Skip that you make sure that you file those pretty quickly.
There was only 1 5.
Oh, one.
15.
Okay, very
one
good.
1 5.
Now, to propel us into our... Thank you very much. Please, let's give a big round of applause to Nate.
Thank you.
And to propel us into our reception that we have now, I'm going to give you my good friend, Carl Martins. Please, welcome.
I was told many years ago never to follow an animal act, a child, or an Aussie, or an Englishman, or an Irishman. They're all the same. I had no idea what to expect today, by the way. I'm so thoroughly impressed with your delivery, Nathan. It was excellent, especially coming from where you're coming from. I don't know if any of you know what a disfluency is, but you didn't use one during the whole speech. Thank you very much, because that irritates the hell out of me. I have been involved with business my whole life, 45 years, 3 different industries, mostly in marketing, training, international companies. At the same time, I pursued a career in the vocal arts. Been an actor, director, choral director, public speaker, voiceover artist. And about 7 years ago, I got to the point where I really got pissed off, because I was attending so many seminars, so many speeches, so many church services, and I was being put to sleep, and I couldn't understand why. And so I decided to put some things together. I did a lot of research, kind of innovative, if you will, since this is an innovation seminar, and reminded me a little bit of a quote by Mark Twain. You all know who Mark Twain is, right? Let's see if we can channel Mark for a minute. He said, "We have not the reverent feelings for the rainbow that the American Indian has, because we know how it's made. I believe we have lost as much as we've gained by prying into the issue." Well, prying is what you're all about. Prying is what I'm all about, have been for many years, different levels. In fact, I think if I had started at the University of Wisconsin, knowing what I know now, having listened to you, I might have stayed in engineering instead. I mentioned Wisconsin, you know, they're on the final 16, the Sweet 16, just had to mention that. Okay. I have the opportunity to speak to a bunch of students here at UCSD several months ago, and was so thoroughly rewarded by their reaction. Why? Because they're going to have to get out someday and possibly talk to investors like you about what their wonderful plan is, and believe it or not, they don't know how to talk. Unless they're talking to their peers, then they do. But you're not going to listen to them unless they really know how to speak, like Nathan did. So I decided to get onto the workshop mode, and I conduct workshops throughout the country, and some individual tutoring, some individual coaching. Locally, I don't want to travel for that, but it's much more rewarding for me. I think the student does a lot better work, a lot faster. Anyway, I would like to suggest that if any of you have anybody you know, yourselves possibly included, that would like to pursue some really innovative ideas about communication, about public speaking, I'll be available afterwards to talk to you. I also published a book about 2 years ago entitled More Than Your Words, Harness the Power of Your Most Effective Speaking Voice. And speaking of speaking, let's have Mark say the final word here. He said, there are two kinds of speakers in this world, those that are nervous and those that are liars. It's funny on the surface, yes. He was a humorist after all. But one of the tenets in my coaching and my workshops is to disprove both of them. You're not a liar and you don't have to be nervous. Thank you. See you later.
Thank you very much. Thank you for channeling Mark Twain into the presentation. We love that. As always, please join us for a nice reception that we're going to have where our speaker will stick around for a little bit and you can talk to Carla as well. Thank you.